I'll turn them up.
Hello. And we'll need to turn up desktop.
Hello. Testing. How's it sound? Hello. Welcome, everyone.
Welcome.
Hello, Internet. Welcome to Thursday Night Live. I'm Jonathan.
I'm Kat Blimke, and we're digital program coordinators at the Mackenzie Art Gallery. So on Thursday nights, we partner with artists and curators to deliver workshops, panels, and screenings that reflect on how to view, how to make, or how to enjoy digital art. So the audience plays a key role in how this happens. If you've tuned in before, you've heard this, but you folks are not only giving you all the links today to participate in the workshop by yourself, but we also are going to be accepting questions. And the way that you ask questions is you use the live chat. And the chat, this is the important feature of any live stream, just type in to whatever you want to say in the chat. If you can't seem to be able to access the chat, make sure you're logged in to your account on the platform you're using to view the stream. You can be using Facebook, YouTube, or Twitch, and it'll all amalgamate for us and we'll be able to see it. Great. We have Risa tuning in and letting us know our levels are great. Thank you.
Risa just said that she could hear. She didn't say that. The levels were great.
I'm
so,
projecting.
we'll see.
For today's workshop, ask your questions anytime. These can be directed at John and myself or our featured audience, Ryan Hill. And you can use the chat function as well to talk to other audience members who are watching the stream. But just remember to be kind because there is another person at the end of that username.
So last week we were talking about the concept of the virtual white cube. And so this week we're going to be continuing our conversation about virtual gallery spaces. But we're actually going to look at how we as artists can make our own virtual art galleries on a computer and what that means. If you haven't seen last week's, don't worry. You can rewatch it at mackenzie.art/livestreams.
I think link's up there on the top.
Oh, yeah, nice.
You still have to type it in, though.
So we're going to be building an art gallery in the free software Unity 3D. We also have another live stream we did a couple of weeks ago about how to use that, but this will also be pretty pretty entry-level stuff that hopefully will be a fun way to learn that program, Unity. And there is a link as well in the chat on Facebook. I might have to post it again on Twitch. But there's a link in the chat on Facebook and YouTube to a project that you can download to get started with in Unity. So today, just like last week, is all about creating these virtual spaces on our computers in digital space, while at the same time the infrastructures of the digital world and the resources it relies on exist on physical land, and we also exist here on physical land, and we'd love to begin by acknowledging the land we are gathered on here, which is Treaty 4 territory, the homeland of the Cree, the Soto, the Lakota, the Nakota, the Dakota, and the Métis people. And you are all gathered wherever you are, and it's always a great time to reflect on the land that we're gathered on. So now that we have successfully introduced the show, the levels have been confirmed to be great by John in the chat. We can finally get to the meat of the show, which is introducing our wonderful guest, Ryan Hill. Or rather, asking Ryan Hill to introduce himself.
Oh, well, thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's a pleasure.
I've been a long time listener, first time caller. I got to check out your last show. I think I've seen most of them, but.
Oh, cool.
So it's nice to be on the other side of this.
Yes. In the hot seat.
In the hot seat. So to introduce myself, I guess I'm a few things here. I'm a multimedia artist. I've worked designing interactive projects for sort of advertising for a number of years, and I'm also a sound artist. Worked in various forms, presenting sound art and working in film and television. And I've been, I guess, a Unity developer for about almost 10 years. Probably, I guess, until maybe around 2012, so 8 years. But,
whoa, that's awesome.
I kind of come from a long history of like making weird internet webs, like flash sites, and mucking around with sort of JavaScript and making sort of generative web stuff.
Yeah, and like I guess like what's interesting about that is at I think a common thing amongst digital artists of like moving between the like art world and the commercial world, because like we can it's this sort of thing of having these skills that the market wants at the same time as they are skills that you want to explore artistically, but it's also a way that you can get a job and it's cool when you can practice any job that I can get where I can work in Unity. I love it because I can get better at using Unity while getting paid.
Yeah, I think my end goal was never really to get paid for it. I just really liked playing with stuff, and I kind of happened to fall into positions where I could get paid for it.
Oh, right on. That's cool. We're talking about a project that is also represented in your Zoom background right now. Right? Is that's one of the photos you took? Or is that a generic dilapidated?
Yeah, that's a photo I took. That's a really blown up photo. The background in my Zoom. Yeah,
yeah,
that's
in your Zoom. Yeah,
that's from one of the buildings in my project. Outside Avonlea, Saskatchewan.
Oh, awesome! And so this is a photogrammetry project. Could you talk a little bit about photogrammetry?
Sure. Yeah. Photogrammetry is essentially like triangulating where a bunch of photos line up together to make a 3D model. You use software to basically process all, say, like 70 photos that are of the same object, and that'll create a 3D model that you can manipulate. It's actually, I was looking at the patents for it. I think the patent goes back to like the early 1800s or 1900s.
That's wild. What part, just like the idea of compositing a 3D thing out of a bunch of photographs, or?
Yeah, like I guess to deduce the general shape of an object by, I think they were using air balloons at the time to kind of, to deduce where, where a 3D point is.
I always love thinking of or finding out the sort of like Victorian age origins of digital technology, like old school stereoscopes
as for 3D. Reality.
Yeah, as the first virtual reality, the like glasses that just gave you a sort of 3D.
Like the image. Slide Masters, if you remember those, the precursors to the Slide View Masters.
An old 100-year-old 3D stereoscopic slot, those objects, the stereoscopic viewer.
Yeah. Wow. Oh, that's awesome. The whole steam, if we were like steampunk digital artists, this is something we could focus on
a lot.
We
would talk about this. this is the project you use photogrammetry to create, Artifacted. We have it in the background here.
We're going to be, we're going to be looking at it in a sort of like virtual gallery setting, which is sort of part of the context of like talking about this work as part of this workshop. But it's embedded in a browser, so I'll just hit I'll start it loading here.
So folks have an idea of what we're talking about. But these models that are represented in the gallery were created through photogrammetry techniques, which Ryan just described.
And could you talk a bit about this, the specific photogrammetry project here? Let me see if I can make this bigger and have you still in the frame.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, nice. Yeah, sorry. Could you talk a bit more about the project in general?
Yeah. Well, I guess I'm sort of expanding on or inspired by a project that's at the Dunlop from I believe the name is it Morshin Aliari? So it's a that project is about creating artifacts. Statues, and then providing sort of the 3D model for people to download and make use of. I'd basically gone through around Saskatchewan, taking photos over the last year, and so these are sort of artifacts from a separate project, which I kind of liked this double or triple layer sort of view on creating artifacts. The idea, I guess, was I wanted it to be fairly focused on looking at the object themselves, and I didn't really spend too much time on creating. I wanted the space to be, fairly simple and focused on being able to look at the details very close up. This originally was going to be a VR project where you could get really close to the objects and kind of lift them up and play with them a little bit more. I had done about 12 buildings around Saskatchewan, and then I kind of thought these were the three sort of best representation of a fully realized building.
How are you choosing these buildings? And they're from all from Saskatchewan, right?
Yeah, I think two of them are from my parents' hometowns. And one of them is from outside of Regina. I didn't really want to be too conscious of where I was going to find them. I because there's so many of them out in the wild of Saskatchewan. Mm-hmm. I wanted to kind of like go a direction and see what I found.
Yeah, part of the sort of the conversation that this project and then Morshin Aliari's project is like engaging in is this idea of preservation. And so it's like it's just made so apparent in the pieces, the scans of the houses here, where they're the sort of like collapsedness and like their like decrepitude is such a big part of the way they look and so captured. And then it sort of has what do you think of the idea of like preserving things like this digitally? How do you envision these artifacts living on in the future beyond when they're like the things they are based on, like eventually totally fall down?
First of all, I really enjoyed the decrepitude of it.
I think that's a word. Yeah.
I wanted it to be falling apart at the seams, and I knew the process of creating these models wouldn't sort of preserve the fully realized version of the building.
Yeah.
I liked the imperfect capture of the building and how imperfect I guess the original building was, and sort of this like layer of imperfection and then going into VR and then having to sort of like, or simplify it further for it to, you know, run in a, be displayed in a, on the web or like all that stuff.
Oh, right on.
Yeah, which is for the inspirational work by Mauricio Aliari, the Material Speculations Isis is the title, and it also the works are 3D printed images or 3D printed objects, not images, that are based off of images of things that have been destroyed, specifically cultural artifacts that have been destroyed. And then also contains the digital information that to be dispersed so that people can enjoy them everywhere, which you've also done here, the ability to, like, people who might not be able to travel right now to see any of these things, even if they're not necessarily going to be traveling specifically to, you know, these are sort of objects that are still exist, yet are maybe not accessible there now in this space that you've created, and would have also been somewhat viewable if it had been in VR as well. There would have been an element of interactivity there.
Yeah, I provided the virtual, like the VR installation is provided as a link on the itch website.
Oh,
if you want to download it.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I totally missed that.
Yeah.
We should check it out for anyone else at home.
I definitely want to get up close to these.
There's a funny aspect to, like, there's like a culture of people going around the countryside looking for old buildings. And there's sort of a, I think there's a point where there's like a preservation, like wanting to not encourage people to go into people's yards and explore these old buildings. I think there was like a website that was dedicated to finding old homes around the province, and sort of like a tourist culture of going to explore these old buildings. And I think it's kind of nice to have them away from where you could be romping around in their yard, the land, exploring the building.
Possibly having a roof collapse on you or something.
Yeah, originally I was going to do this project where I was going into buildings, but I kind of felt that it wasn't. I didn't feel safe enough.
Yeah, I. Well, certainly with these buildings here, so the roofs don't exist, and
yeah, that's, in this one.
It's very possible.
I love that aspect situation. Though, like you had mentioned, the imperfection of the scans. But how did you get the great scans of the roofs of the buildings? Is that just what the photogrammetry was able to do, or did you use a drone or something?
I just did a circle around the building, and I used my iPhone and took about 70 photos per building, and depending on where I was standing, I could capture pretty much the whole roof.
And was that an
One of the buildings I couldn't really get the roof, and the middle building kind of has a big hole on the top of it.
Were you just using photographs? Oh, here's the hole. Were you using just the photograph tool that you then stitched together later, or was there a specific app that you were using?
I'm using a tool called MetaShape. It's a kind of a standard photogrammetry tool. It's about $150 or something to use it. There's some like newer apps on like your iPhone that you can use to go do photogrammetry. That's I haven't really played with it at all. I did one or two things with it, but I didn't want to use it for this project.
I really like this model. It looks really nice.
Go for it, Ryan.
I was like cautious. I didn't want to remove too much of the errors on the buildings. I ended up cutting out a lot of like just grass and kind of weird objects that were in sort of clouds that would be photogrammetry turned into photogrammetry.
Whoa.
Yeah, like there's a bit of a cloud edge of the sky on you can see to the right of that. Oh, that's what I imagine that is, that blue. Looks very similar to the blue in your background zoom photo.
Whoa. But I really love the distortion of the roof shingles. and a lot of the wood kind of does this neat pattern, this kind of melting pattern. Yeah. This building here, I walked around the building and I kind of didn't realize that I had actually captured the insides of the building.
Yeah, look at that. That's wild.
In so, VR, you can actually dip your head inside the building and look at it.
Cool. So you only discovered that you had captured the inside after you did the photogrammetry process?
Yeah, I didn't really notice. Well, I'd been getting close enough to, I guess, to the hole to get the insides of the building, but I just didn't know that it came through after.
I love the slant on you. Mm-hmm. Really captured the slant on this too. So one aspect I think that is often common to digital art is the sort of like highlighting artifacts, not the artifacts in, or not necessarily the artifacts like we think of in a museum or a gallery, but the what you call what are sort of like the leftover parts of the digital processes that we use to create pieces. Right, yeah. So like that's that would be like the cloud, the whatever you would call that cloud bits oozing off the corners,
your cloud distortions.
Yeah, like those are, or more straightforward examples, sort of classic examples would be pixelation in images. Those are like digital artifacts, and so that's one. I think that's it's awesome because the title of your piece, Artifacted, has all those different contexts, and also makes it awesome for this. This show here, we're trying to think about all the different aspects of digital art and focusing on artifacts of the digital process is a huge part of that, because the sort of interest in that, I think, is partly about wanting to think of the materiality of the digital, when so often what we think of as digital technology we think as being immaterial. So as artists, we want to focus on that. But maybe zooming out to another level of material, so we sort of have to go a bit meta on from talking about the piece itself to maybe talking a bit about what you created around the piece. Mm-hmm. That you made. Specifically, these beveled plinths. I love them.
So, yeah, I'd spent a lot of time talking to Eric at the Dunlop about what the specific dimensions of the plinths were there.
in the creation of this piece, after it was determined that the VR work would not be able to be publicly displayed due to the closure.
No, it was meant for the actual VR experience, because I wanted it to feel like the real scale of the building. Or the real scale of the gallery. And so I was imagining that this would be next to a bunch of plinths in the gallery. I guess it was going to be off to the side, but I've tried to find the best measurements for 3D modeling this fairly simple cube. And I wanted to create a boundary that made it blocked you from moving too much. I wanted people to know where they had to stand.
Shout out from Eric in the chat.
Plinth measurer.
Couldn't have happened without you.
I really like the do not touch. Isn't that a nice touch?
Yeah, I debated a lot over whether I should put that in there or not.
Well, it's funny because it's instead of being it's almost, I don't know what you would call it, almost a bit bittersweet or something of a statement, because usually it's almost a bit of like a thing that a security guard might be saying to you. But in this case, it's like, oh, I wish I could touch any of this stuff. But no, it's digital. You'll never be able to touch it.
Well, yeah, in the VR version, I wanted people to sort of break the rules and try to affect it. Because you normally don't have permission, so I kind of wanted to give people the subversive permission to do that. But it was a lot of fun when you could grab the objects and toss them around.
Yeah, it's I definitely am looking forward to downloading the virtual reality version. I did not notice that on the page.
So the objects are interactive in virtual reality as well. You can manipulate them.
Yeah, you can grab them with your hands and toss them around.
That's awesome.
Yeah, this is kind of remarking on one of the things we mentioned last week in the panel, sort of like choosing or the medium specificity of digital galleries, VR galleries that require headsets being a bit less accessible because you have to invest in the hardware before being able to view something. So this version of the project that you've created, while it doesn't allow for the interactivity of VR that you can like push and grab and the digital images, it still allows a broader audience to access the work, which is also, I think, with the kind of concept of both your own project and the project that inspired it, very integral to the ideas of behind your work. Just want to highlight that. Make sure people get it. It's great.
I was a bit cautious about using text. I kind of didn't want to have too much in there. I didn't know if I should put my title in there, but since it's online, I kind of thought it was good to have some labeling in there, but I wanted it as pure as possible.
Right. I feel like with the plinths already, it's sort of, especially in this like sort of browser context, it's already like leaning into the gallery aesthetic, or the look of an art gallery as an aesthetic to be applied to something. So I think that's another sort of specificity that makes this a nice use of the sort of virtual gallery space.
Another thing to point out is, I guess you can rotate around the objects in this version. But at one point I made it so you could walk around the space and sort of get into the corners of the room. But I kind of felt like that was, a distraction from the objects too.
Yeah. Right. Oops. People will be thinking too much about like where they're positioned.
I keep going through the wall.
It's nice when you can focus like this orbiting around them makes you focus right at them. So. Yeah, this is probably the better way. We're going to look at you built this in Unity, right?
Yeah.
And then we're going to look at building our own galleries in Unity in a minute. And when I was doing that, I was just also thinking about lighting and sort of virtual, how you have to light virtual spaces virtually. And so I think you have some like lights on in this room because I see some shadows and stuff.
Yeah, I actually spent a lot of time trying to get the ideal lighting. So I had these top-down spotlights, and I wanted shadows to be casting on the walls and kind of showing off. Also, there's some like artifacts in the light shadows shadows.
Like down there, you can kind of.
Awesome. Some strange things that are created out of these lighting patterns that I'm doing.
Yeah. It's something I hadn't really thought of much before today when I was setting up the project we'll be building off of, this sort of question, but obviously it's a consideration that you need to make of not only building your virtual space, but then how do you light your virtual space?
Yeah, and I had wanted like the lighting to make the walls sort of like not too white. I didn't want them, I don't know if I got to the perfect shade of gray.
Yeah, right.
But I did some baked lighting is the term. So trying to make more realistic sort of shadows on the edges of the walls and stuff.
Cool.
It's very much informed. The gray seems to really respond to the gray of the exposed wood shingles that have been deteriorating.
I think also the lighting online kind of is diminished a little bit compared to the VR version. Right. Mm.
Probably a lower quality setting for a WebGL thing.
Yeah.
I'm excited to see that. Mm-hmm. VR version. Do you want to look at a couple of the other VR galleries before we get, or do you want to just go straight into building our own?
Well, I think it's a good idea to give some folks ideas of, different ideas of what Unity-based VR galleries could be. But make sure you share the link to Artifacted on the chat. As we mentioned before, this is a piece that was commissioned by the Dunlop Art Gallery for in response to the exhibit The Art Happens Here, Net Art's Archival Poetics, which is currently installed, but I believe not accessible at the central branch of the Dunlop. But luckily, we have this, we're able to explore this this piece online. And the link's in the chat that you can also, you don't have to download it, you can just launch it in browser. And then we have a few other gallery spaces that we are just going to visit in order to give folks an idea of, or just different ideas of what can be done in Unity, specifically when you're creating these spaces that vamp on physical gallery spaces, but are digital gallery spaces.
Just need to extract a file. I didn't extract it before the show.
Oh, we'll bring up. You could bring up another one.
The other one, yes.
They're Panther Modern, or. So, as everyone, if everyone is has the Unity downloaded now, or do people still need a bit more time?
Well, they they're gonna have a bit more time still to do it. We are going to start working in Unity in a second, so you can download both Unity, and then there's a sort of pre-made project in Unity that I've shared in the chat. So this is a project by Pippin Barr, who is a video game artist
working out of Montreal.
Yes, mm-hmm. And Ryan, you were just telling us that this actually showed at the Dunlop.
Yeah, maybe a year ago. Eric would know.
Eric, you're in the chat. Tell us. Tell us the details.
Eric from the Dunlop. I'm also a big fan of water simulations.
Sorry, I'm going a bit fast.
It's a big thing in Unity, especially. There's a lot of different ways you can like have water appear and. I like them a lot too.
Yeah, so this is VR3, I believe is how you pronounce the title, and it's a gallery, it's a simulated gallery game that is just about like tech fetishism, in the artist's words, and the gallery space is created to sort of recreate the contemplative element of looking at something in a gallery space, where all these are different tech demos, essentially, of different ways of displaying water, rendering water in Unity, the software that we'll be using. It's a room filled with plinths that are filled with different kinds of water or different water shaders. So in this artwork, it's intentionally referencing the gallery space for the way that it makes you, the viewer, interact with the work in order to sort of put the tech on a pedestal, but also in a way that's very like reflexive of kind of the tech industry, or the consumption of this technology in general.
But I also love how
so pretty
Pippin Barr credits all the artists and the people behind the shader, behind the water shaders, mm-hmm. who are not normally people who would probably consider themselves as artists, because a lot of them just have like usernames or screen names from whatever forum they posted this stuff on or what their Unity asset store name is. Eric was just confirming that it was the first Game Stations game that he programmed.
Oh, wow.
So love it. Wonderful. We didn't know that when we were choosing this to include in talking tonight that it showed here. It's just that good. folks. and it's also awesome because it has the prices of some of these waters, so it probably costs a good chunk of change.
I've definitely bought some of these in my search for the perfect water shader.
Yeah.
And then, of course, there's so this is available free for download, and we will post the link in the chat. Do we have the other examples up?
Yeah, I just have to run it. The only other example I had was Ben and Kale's game.
All right. Yeah, that's cool. So a cluster festival in Winnipeg, which normally happens around this time, has instead moved all of their programming this year online. So one of the pieces featured in this year's online programming is a game called Are We Having Fun Yet? By Benjamin McCarthy and Cale Weir. And so Are We Having Fun Yet? As it loads, I'll give you a little sneak peek, it highlights this particular action that occurs in the in a physical gallery space, which is taking selfies with the art. So the navigation of space in the game itself is...
Hey influencers, whoa. And welcome to this week's episode. How are you? Yes, I'm so excited to start with all this.
More. Maybe a little more. Oh yeah, mute tab. Okay. Thanks.
Hello.
All right. so it's the mechanic of the game, which is to take selfies beside these digital representations of art. Sometimes these are real recreations of existing works, like there's Jeff Koons' Balloon Dog in here, and sometimes they're originals created by the artists.
Wait, I want to just restart it so we can get the webcam working, because you're supposed to be able to take pictures of yourself.
The game itself works with your webcam, your embedded webcam in your computer, so you are able to take selfies in the piece. So we're just allowing access. Oh, yes. They're here. Okay, so you can see us taking selfies in the virtual gallery. Ah, a couple photo.
And then I think.
Oh, we're in the ground.
If you, I'm really impressed that the camera works in browser. This is the gallery you can explore. And this is, I love this example of a virtual gallery, because it's like...
There's a lot of digital artifacts and elements, of course, that couldn't be reproduced or couldn't be represented in a physical gallery space, but are able to be navigated around and composed within your selfie image here. And then there's, as you heard earlier, there's audio and a sort of more of a didactic element with the description and audio that is overlaid as you walk around the gallery space.
Yeah, it's quite nicely laid out. Eventually your own selfies start appearing on the wall somewhere. I should have speed ran this to find out where that was. But here, we could take a picture.
Let's
with
take
us
a picture. Next. And Ryan, and Ryan's like kind of in this picture because his Zoom call is like right there, so we can all. If anyone's taking screen captures on their computers right now, send them
screen
to
capture.
Us. Time in the gallery. So that's another. That's a piece that's currently on the. Yeah. Currently online for Cluster Festival.
Let me see what
clusterdigitaledition.com. We're just copying this link and putting it in the chat.
What we like about that version of an online gallery is this sort of like thinking about this part of art gallery culture, like selfies, and making that a part of the virtual gallery itself, making it sort of this thing that's commenting on the whole phenomenon of art galleries, or this behavior that takes place in art galleries. So, do you want help?
No, I'm good. I was just going to bring up Panther Modern, but
okay, cool.
Yeah, just quickly.
Yeah, do it.
Yeah, another example, the long-standing digital art gallery is Panther Modern. One sec, I did spell it right. Which is run by Literbo Avedon, who is an artist and digital avatar. Here we go. And this is a virtual art gallery. You can see in the background, this is sort of the layout. And it the gallery invites artists to create site-specific installations for the virtual gallery. So these are, in this case, these are works that are 3D models, very specific environments created for this space that explore like these limitations of, you know, physical space in a virtual space, or however you might think that. And there's lots of different rooms as you would find in a physical gallery space. So there's kind of this idea of progressing through this digital this digital architecture. There's Mauricien Alghiari, who an artist that we're that was the inspiration for Ryan's earlier piece, also was had shown work last year at the Mackenzie Art Gallery. Has a room here with Andrew Blanton that might not. Looks like we have to download it. But we'll share the link to that in the chat because we did not download that prior. Is not running all the time. Again, one of those
older version of Unity.
Yeah, that revisiting our conversation last week about virtual galleries, or the kind of virtual galleries that require web extensions that can be outdated very quickly, and then you'll no longer be able to access them in the same way.
Yeah.
I don't know much about like the whole history of archiving these old web pages that no longer function. I feel like there's an initiative out there.
Yeah. The NetArt anthology, or there was an archive that Rhizome put out, which sort of was combined with a lot of the exhibit that is at the Dunlop right now was drawn from, which seeks to archive a lot of these very specific these specific works that require specific technology plugins of a certain era. In this case, in the work that we're looking at, that is not the case. But
I think this is the website itself.
This is the website. So if you just delete that part of the title, you can see sort of this archive of these works. And yeah, that is a really common phenomenon, kind of in curating these works or obtaining these works for collections is, you know, how will this run if you don't have a computer specifically in this era with all the software installed that makes it work? But yeah, that's a something to think about.
Yeah, I'll just paste this link.
Yeah, so folks can explore it.
Yeah, I think there's a few different archives out there. I know there's one about BBS art.
Oh, really? Oh,
thank you, Eric, for posting that.
Old chat rooms or modern, like Newgrounds is a place for a lot of like flash game art installation kind of stuff.
Yeah, and yeah, those places where like everyone who is famous from being a indie video game person now got their start making stuff, which also probably evaporates or slips through the cracks. It's like very, yeah, it's important to have things like this happening to try to collect those, like all of the digital culture that's been created over the past 30, 40 years together. Because otherwise it just disappears. I lost MySpace erasing all of its music files in 2013. I think I lost so many things.
Yeah, you should learn from Jonathan. Back up your files. Don't rely on proprietary.
MySpace.
don't rely on proprietary.
I backed up my
technology.
Entire computer on MySpace. They just deleted everything.
but let's create our own. I think we should move on to creating our own virtual ephemeral gallery spaces.
Totally.
Yeah. Let's okay.
So we're gonna start by opening up Unity Hub. We're gonna go sort of from the beginning with anyone else who wants to follow along, and yeah, we can, we'll start building our own galleries. And then if you want to, we could try to put, if you make galleries as well, you could, we could try to put them all together into one gallery. That would be an ambitious, goal for
this. But doable, definitely doable.
And then if you want to sort of join that conversation a bit more, intimately, click on the link wherever it is here.
Or there, type here. In this link.
Oh, you can click on it?
I don't think so with Facebook.
Oh, on Facebook? Yeah. Yes, right. If you hit that link, you'll be able to join our Discord server. And then in a little bit, we'll open up the Zoom call. So if other people want to come on and show the work they're doing, that they can. But let's get started by making a whole new project. If you haven't already, download the... I put a bit.ly link in the chat with the Unity package in it, but we can go ahead and make a new one. New project. You can call
new
it.
New virtual gallery. Just running.
So Unity's going to start up, and then... the bit.ly link that I posted in the chat has a Unity package in it. And so what a Unity package is, it's a sort of like an exported Unity project that you can then import into your own Unity project. So in that package, I've built a little gallery room with a sculpture and a piece of video art and an image, a photographic art. And so you can use those and sort of like change up what they are. Which is what Kat is going to be doing to make her own room. So I sort of have one room, and then we could all make our own little gallery rooms. And then, yeah, like I was saying, put them all together, hopefully.
Hey, Christine. Uh-oh, Discord invite expired. Wait, that wasn't the new one?
I forgot to put the new one in. Oh no.
Oh, Reese, I'm so sorry. Here, let me get a new...
We'll just copy, paste this link into the chat.
Yeah, here. This.
So you won't have to even type it anymore. Put it, go to OBS.
Here it is. New link.
Should we all join Discord?
Yes, we should. Everyone quickly abandon Zoom. Although I don't think it lets you do the automatic background green screening, does it?
Not on that one.
Discord.
Yeah. Permanent link.
What version of Unity are you using?
Oh, 2019.2, I believe. I think.
We just opened it.
I can't remember what it said. We'll find out in a minute. The things that we're working with here should be simple enough that they would just open in any. Unity package that you have, it has the standard assets imported into it already. So that would be the only.
Here we go.
And the standard assets are made to work with older Unity.
And
it should be good.
And that package is just at the top of the chat, or
I posted it pretty recently.
Okay, cool.
All right, let's post it again.
Yeah, that's, we're just posting it again for folks who have joined recently or care rather not to scroll. Yeah.
Okay, our Unity is slowly. Gotta love programs these days. 2019.3 is what we're using.
And we will not be updating on this.
So now what we did, you would have downloaded, you'd have downloaded the package called virtualgallery.mckenzie.tnl. So once you have Unity open, you can just double click on that package. And then if you have Unity open while you double-click on a Unity package, it'll just open that package up in Unity, and we'll wait for a bit more loading to do. If you want, you have some other people's bedtimes responsibilities to do, so anytime you have to check out to do those things.
Is this a 3-hour workshop?
Yeah, we're going all night. It was like a 24-hour telethon.
No, we should be wrapping up before 8:30.
Yeah, before 8:30, I would say we try to get out of here.
I'm going to hit import on this in the import Unity package. Everything's there.
Yeah, everything.
And you should, too, also hit import if you're following along.
Whoever you are out there.
Risa. I know Risa.
I'm curious to watch tips and tricks.
Yeah, it's going to be pretty good. You're going to like, so I made a kinetic light sculpture based on the work of Bauhaus member Laszlo Moholy-Nagy. So I'm looking forward to debuting that in my virtual gallery space. And then, so what you're going to do, okay, so now you want to open up, see, it just opened up the console here. Mm-hmm. Go back to the project panel.
So that was just a tab that I navigated over to.
Yeah. Let's switch our layout to default just all because. Right, so yeah, Windows. Layouts, default.
Oh, mate, it went so small.
Okay, cool. So project, great.
I'm just going to put Ryan. Wait,
because then he's behind us.
Oh yeah.
We just have to make him slightly smaller.
We're just making him slightly smaller. Like this. There we go. And then we can be right here. Right?
Oh, folks are hung up registering with Unity. Right. Yeah, that's annoying. We can certainly we can just wait until If you are registering with Unity, just
make sure you're registering for a personal account. Sometimes that's not immediately obvious because it is when you go download Unity, they usually give you a slew of options that are I'll just bring it up right now. So oops, it's the wrong window. I'll just bring it up right now. So if you are downloading Unity, we're gonna get. Is this the button? Yeah. So you want to not go to business. Unless you really want to go to business. You go to individual and you hit personal here. Then you don't have to fill in any of your. It's free. It's free for everyone as long as you are someone
make less than $100,000.
Yeah. In the last 12 months alone from using this software, from a product you developed using the software. So make sure that what I did was I hit get started. I navigated over from business to individual, and then you get started down here if you're going from the main page. And then you probably have to put in your email in order to sign up, and that gives you the email sort of links your own folders and projects together in the cloud. So there's sort of that's the logic behind, you know, giving them your personal information.
It's good. Mm-hmm. It's my favorite program.
how are folks now?
We'll start bringing stuff, or let's just explore the thing I made at least first.
Yeah, let's just take a look at it.
We can go over any of this again for you folks who are
following along.
Yeah, mm-hmm. In the chat, and maybe even you might want to join on a Zoom call where we could give even more directed instruction. But
there'll be an after party in the Discord.
Yeah. So, if you, Kat, want to just click on the Seams tab there, and then jump into the virtual galleries.
So I've got two options here. There's sample scene, but I'll be choosing. The virtual gallery. Wow. And
then, wait, go to click on game.
Yeah.
And click maximize on play.
What do I see
Let's
here?
Press play. So there's my photographic work.
This is our wall hung work.
Yeah.
Our wall based works in the gallery.
Just brings a smile to your face. And then turn over that way to see there. Wow. There's my kinetic sculpture. Kinetic sculptural work.
Amazing.
Yeah. So that's why I was thinking of the lighting thing. I was thinking of the lighting thing looking at your work as well, because I was like, oh yeah, get a put. I have well, this is just some like lights are attached to the sculpture. That's annoying how it's bouncing around like that. Oh.
Do you feel like the frame rate drops with those lights or like?
That's what it feels like, but it doesn't seem to me.
No, I think there's something weird with this character controller where it's like,
oh, it's doing the head bob.
It's clipping in the ground, and that might be the thing that looks like the frame rate dropping. Wait, let me try. Never mind. we'll just keep ignore the bouncing.
It's kind of like you're slowly sinking in quicksand. Yes. In virtual quicksand, but it's not. I promise it's not going to affect your experience with the art.
So yeah, this is my kinetic light sculpture. It's a ball that rotates slowly with a bunch of like hinged arms that I put on it with point lights at the end of each hinged arm. And then over here I have a video work, which is it's a camera slowly orbiting the room. And then this is the feed of that camera. So it's like a, what would you call that? A live video feed, referencing early video works.
And what's this if I go to the next room? This is behind me. What happens if I try to go to the next room?
Just like outside every
and the wall disappears.
There's an endless plane of water that if you try to step out onto.
What is this? The Venice Biennale?
You can just walk on.
That's actually very satisfying. Okay, I'm out of here.
You don't fall down forever on this?
No, I added a box collider to the water.
Nice.
Yeah, I feel like it's like every Unity project has to involve some degree of falling forever. If you walk to the end of the water.
Or water simulation. Maybe it's like either or.
Hey, are you, Risa, are you, sorry, dude. Sometimes people don't like when you address them by name in the chat, but we're all friends here. But so do you have Unity open on your computer? Are we caught up to that degree?
Oh yeah. And for folks wondering, you can't actually see the location of the camera that's putting that like is delivering this input.
It's
but it
exists.
If you look at the scene, you're able to see it. Just
and
not
your,
in the game
your character, too. Your character doesn't have a body?
Yeah, your character, exactly. That's your character is also invisible. Let me show you a bit behind the scenes. Take a look under the hood. So here's this is the orbiting camera right here. So you can see this is what this little camera icon represents, the virtual camera. And then, yeah, this is my character controller. And then why are they bouncing? Anyway, let's try building out.
It's on your new laptop, Risa.
Let's try building out your own space here.
Yes. Okay. Kat. I'm gonna just drag this down so I can see a bit more in the gallery, and I'll turn off this play.
On that cat photo, those arrows on the side don't do anything.
No, that's I just screen captured Unity in my browser. Sorry, screen capped Instagram in my browser because you can't
save
image on Instagram in your browser, so you have to do a screen capture.
So that's because it's actually part of a triptych that I published this afternoon.
And I was actually trying to highlight the qualities of the medium of Instagram by, integrating the arrows into the piece.
Yes, this is an intentionally screen-based work produced for digital screens.
Yeah.
Just so I could show everyone how ridiculous my cat looked.
This piece in particular is entitled, The Mlem is the Money. Talking about the new currency of cat pictures on the internet in Instagram. moving on, we're going to build out our own room, Kat. Where we can start is I have a sort of prefabricate. Oh, cool.
Yeah, Risa, I'm trying to get my thumbs up in the frame.
So to come to the place where we are at.
We opened up, what we were doing is we downloaded this package that was the bit.ly link.
Yeah, if you have Unity open itself, and you double click on this package, it will you'll be able to it'll open up in Unity. Mm-hmm. Itself.
So I just double clicked that, and then I had to hit import once it loaded in Unity, but then it brought in this scene, which is located in the scene. If you go to assets in this panel down here, the project panel, the top level asset folder, there's then this folder called scenes that has the virtual gallery scene, which I'm using, and you can see it's sort of open because it says so up here. It's indicating that up here.
So let's go. If you jump into the folder in your project panel, so just, oh wait, let's really quickly go over the different panels.
Right. Yeah. All the different
Unity.
Interface.
For a better first look at Unity, watch our earlier live stream, world building in Unity.
You can find it at the link up there, but you also have to type that one in.
But first, very quickly, in Unity you work in scenes, so we can look in our scene in the scene viewer right here.
Yes.
This scene viewer, you can navigate around it using your mouse, ideally a mouse with a scroll wheel in the middle. To the left of our scene view, we have our hierarchy where we see all the different things that are in our scene. So if you go over to the hierarchy there, that's a list of all the different objects that are in our scene. And then if you select one of those objects, like...
The water per daytime.
And then take a look at the other side of the scene panel to the right. That's our inspector panel.
I'll just move you over here for a second, Ryan.
Yes, excuse me.
pardon. Just
That you'll see your inspector panel, which tells you different information. Would you click on a different one? Tells you different information based on what you have selected.
Flat art.
That's... Below that is your project panel.
This one down here.
So in your project panel, you have all the different assets that you're using to build your project that you are putting into your scene. So like 3D models, textures and images, a variety of different things. So we're going to look in our project panel down there first in a folder called prefabs. So in prefabs, there will be this gallery object. And so these are 3D objects that I built that you can now add to your scene. So if you click and drag gallery into the scene.
Ooh, here it is.
Yeah, that'll put your room in. You want to put it maybe on the other side of that?
Yeah, will it snap?
Maybe. Not really.
You probably have to walk around. Here, I'll... I'm manipulating it in space with controls that you can find up here on this toolbar. So that the different options here prompt different kinds of actions that you can take with the objects in your scene. So this, what I was just using was transform, which allows me to move things in physical space. There's along the different axes that are also, as a gentle reminder up here, that showing you what is the Y, X, and Z axis. Then there's rotate, which would allow me to put my gallery in the water if I wanted to. And as well as scale, if I wanted to have the biggest and best gallery, I could make it a lot bigger. Why don't I make it slightly bigger? Just so I'll put my gallery. I'll be rotating it. Is there a wall? Are there walls? The walls seem to be.
Well, the walls are two dimensional, not three dimensional, like in a normal art gallery, you know.
My gallery is like sized for modern painting works,
yeah.
Like color fields, so it has to be a bit taller.
My gallery had three dimensional walls.
for the record.
It's not normal to have two dimensional walls. I should have put the lights in the prefab.
Mm-hmm.
But if you want to add, you could just copy one of these lights if you click on the spotlight.
The hierarchy?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I'll just show what I'm looking at.
Yeah. And then if you duplicate that, you could just right click on it here and then hit duplicate. and then move that. So then this light you can now move over to your gallery space.
My much better gallery space. Yeah.
Nice.
And then I can, and in order to adequately light, you can rotate it using that upper that tool up here. I'm also going to be probably out of habit using the shortcut, which is W for move, E for rotate, R for scale, which doesn't make sense unless you look at the keyboard and you realize those are all next to each other. But they don't they're, it's not R for rotate, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. So I'm switching to a transform to sort of give this a dramatic stage lighting. So I've got a gallery. I've got four walls, one that hopefully I can walk through,
yeah.
And a light in my gallery. What next?
Let's add our first work of art. Let's add an image.
Oh, okay.
So if you want to click on flat art in your project panel, in your prefab panel there, you can just drag that onto your wall to some degree. Oh,
it might be backwards.
It's backwards. Okay, so you got to rotate it.
I can do that over here in the inspector panel.
Yeah, so if you, I think, rotate it where it says Y, rotation Y, switch that to, I guess, minus 90.
And you could also do this with the tools that I just demonstrated on the toolbar, but this just allows you to get an accurate 90-degree rotation.
And the Unity package should work in Mac. So if you have Unity open, you have to have Unity open like we do now, and then you double click on that Unity package.
This looks great.
Yeah.
My painting's even bigger than yours.
It's part of a series. why don't we find an... You have to pick a different image. I've already copyrighted that image in my art gallery. So.
Oh. Recess. So the hub. You installed the hub. Okay. We'll. You should be able to install a build of Unity from the editor, the hub, or the.
Do that, and then we'll do. We're gonna have more people jump on the Zoom call, or we're just gonna share the Zoom call link in a second. Mm-hmm. And then if you wanted, so if you started downloading now, then we could help you more directly than this indirect position. But it's all good. You have to pick a different image.
Oh.
Just so people see how to add images,
right,
too.
I mean, this one's great.
Okay, yeah, let's stick with this.
No, we can add a different image. Do we have another image of Sam?
you have to go. So if you go to Sam's Instagram.
Okay, makes sense. I'm just going to his.
Use the other side.
Okay,
see it.
Right. That's true.
Or
I guess my Instagram has
go to your Instagram
today. So you can get the triptych. So yeah, this is just how he looked.
And then if you right click on it, I just found this out, and then go to take a screenshot. Yeah.
And of course, if you're on Mac, you can just use Command Shift 4 to take a.
Yeah.
Oh wow! Look at this. It actually gives me a specific. Okay, so let's download that, and let's get the final of the triptych.
I'm glad that we are able to incorporate these images into our job tonight.
our artist practice. All right, so we've got those. I believe those downloaded.
Yeah.
So now I'm going to go to my download folder. Bring that over here so folks can see. I'm just going to rename them. So Sam 2. So that and then I'm just going to go back to Unity.
Yeah, go back in Unity. So then there's a textures folder.
Cool. Go in here.
And you can just drop them in there. So you can treat your projects panel in Unity like it's a folder or a what do you call it, a finder or an explorer window. You can just drop files into it.
So now we have more textures.
Yeah. So now you have to make a new material for our new painting. So let's just right-click here and make a new material. So
should I make it in the materials section?
If you want to.
I see that there is a materials
section. Yeah, so you could do two things. You could either right-click, create material, call this SAM2 maybe. And then, or you could click on the one that I've called art and just duplicate that.
Right click.
And you might have to hit Control D. Just with it selected.
Control D or Command D for Max.
Yeah.
I think you can also drag the image directly onto that plane.
But won't that... let's try that, because I thought that would be really nice. I was just thinking that it would... Go back to textures. Let's give that a try. I was just thinking that that would overrule what the texture for all of that material.
I think it creates a new material when you do it.
Well, I have to... I think...
No.
Yeah. It's not allowing me to drag and drop.
Drop it on there.
Oh, drop it on... What if I have this selected, then this? Okay.
Oh, it does. Brilliant.
Great. Yeah. That's See, so this nice. Is why we have our special guest, Ryan Hill, on for his expertise.
It'll create a material in the folder, and then you can go organize it after, too.
Oh, nice. So, yeah, they've already...
I think it's in the main assets folder, maybe?
No, I think it put it in the materials folder. It must have put it in SAM2.
Because that's the image name, perhaps? I thought the image name was SAM02.
No, it made... Wait, did it make it? Anyway,
wild. This is confusing. So, this
the
is
ghost
the one I
in
created.
The machine. So now...
Yeah, SAM2 is the one it created.
Sam's looking awesome there. We want to add another sculpture to your gallery too now.
No, actually, I'll just also make another one of these.
Oh yeah, for the
for the other for the triptych. So I'm just gonna Control D, duplicate this.
I think you could also
probably zero. Oh no, wait, wait, negative zero. Can I do that? No, that's called 180, I guess. Then. And then, the final. There we go.
Oh, that's awesome. Do you want to use this third one as well?
No, it can be these. You know, these are.
But then you could have a Sam gallery.
Yeah, I guess you're right. Okay.
I think it's the right idea.
So I'll be taking this art. I believe this is a loan. Our contract's in the mail. But we'll be taking this now.
Can I see
I'm
something?
I'm going to make it a little bigger. Yep. Here. That's more the scale that I want.
Nice. Okay, great. Yeah, these are looking good. Okay, now I think you should have a sculpture in the middle of the space.
I agree.
So let's go back to our prefabs folder and grab that sculpture object. So it comes with a plinth.
Oh, it's so small.
Truly massive space.
Whoops. Those aren't standard dimensions, I don't think.
Yeah. It's okay, it's in there.
So now we want to... So if you look at that sculpture object,
mm-hmm.
if you... It has a plinth, and then it has just an empty space where you can put the sculpture. So I'm just going to quickly navigate over to where there is a useful sculpture we can use.
There it is.
There we go. I think this is it.
Yeah, that's it, right? New Sam model blender.
Yeah. Okay, bring our sculpture, loading our sculpture in the loading bay. Okay, let me just get rid of that thing that is giving me an error. Didn't need this script. Okay, so now If you drag that, so drag Sam into where it says place sculpture. Great.
Oh, and he's going to need this material.
Yeah. And then his legs need the material too.
Oh, yeah. So what we're doing here, if you have a sculpture that's a 3D model, you will also need to assign the materials on it, which is an option thing that you do within the inspector panel. And if this is something that folks are doing, we can go into more detail. Just let us know in the chat, or we'll just keep using this as an example.
Yeah.
Oops.
I was trying
to move the legs. Oops. Oh no.
Can you zoom into the cat?
Yes.
Yeah. Mom? Give us yes. That close up.
I will.
Click on new Sam model itself, and sort of he's weirdly centered. So move him over. Yeah, and then.
We might have to make this plinth a bit bigger, or yeah. I guess he can kind of balance on there.
No, you can make. You should make the plinth bigger.
Will it? Will the plinth itself?
Yeah.
And then I'll just grab that. I'm going to scale on that toolbar.
Yeah.
Perfect.
I think you should make... So right now we're using an unlit texture for Sam. I think you should make it lit, but then have like multiple spotlights.
Right. That's a good... How do I change that?
So you just with this selected, see where it says shader up there in the inspector panel?
So I navigated over to this
or
little
click
material.
On Sam. This will just be more direct. Click on Sam and then click on Sam again so it selects his body instead of the whole object. And then scroll down to the bottom of your... No. Oh, yeah. Nice. And then scroll down to the bottom of the inspector panel.
Which is where my head is in the stream.
Okay, never mind. Let's just select the material itself. It'll be too hard to see if our head is there. Okay, so with the material we've selected, we're just going to change the shader. Risa says, make him big.
We can make him like balloon dog size. He doesn't even need a plinth.
Yeah, indeed. So let's change it from an unlit texture.
Mm-hmm.
To a, if you go to standard.
Standard specular or standard?
Sure. Specular. Sure. Doesn't, yeah.
moody.
Yeah. And then crank, I would say crank up his smoothness. Just saying. Make him all the
way smooth. Yeah, he's beautiful.
And then I would, let's also make him bigger. Like
okay,
Risa
yeah,
suggested.
Like Risa said. So
you could just make the whole sculpture bigger.
Well, yeah, maybe
make the whole click on sculpture.
Yeah.
And now just make this thing bigger.
Whoa.
And I'll just like bring it up a little bit so he has a bit of a platform.
You should do a player test to see how it feels.
He's so perfect. Yeah, see, let us
press
see.
Press play. I'll be in the other room when I start. Oh, I should have rotated him too. Okay, so that painting's
gone. Hey, where'd my
gone.
Art go?
Oh, boring. This room's so boring.
Your security camera didn't do.
Yeah.
It was looking the other way. Wow. It is very balloon animal-y.
He's looking at himself in this one. That's quite beautiful. Wow.
That specular shine.
Yeah.
How many polygons on that cat?
Very few.
No butt details there.
Yeah.
No cat butt. He's got the tongue though, right?
Yeah, in he's definitely got the tongue in the model.
Let's get some light.
You think you have... do you think you have enough pictures of your cat to do photogrammetry of the cat?
I really should. I feel like I have enough photos of my cat to probably create a new cat through machine learning. So we'll see that. We'll see how that turns out. But that's a really good. That's a good thing to. A good experiment to try. I'm gonna move him around too, so I look at him. Yes.
When you first come in.
When you first arrive.
And then you got to put like.
Yeah, he needs some spotlights.
But before you do that, can I just share an invite to the video in the Discord? So if you want to join the Zoom, Just head on over to the Discord.
So if folks have been working on their own galleries, or
just want to chat,
just want to say hi,
or need want to have some feedback. How do you change the height of your virtual audience?
Yes, this is a good, very good point coming from a curator, because there is a sort of standard height that is assumed when you are hanging an art show. Do you know what that height is? Like 5'8" or 5'6" or something?
If you go to do that change,
photosymmetry.
Good one. If you go to your rigid body FPS controller.
Okay, in my hierarchy panel.
Yeah, collapse it for a second, just so I can show how you uncollapse it.
Mm. Oh yes, open this little arrow over here.
So you want to look at the main camera, and then move Ryan. Actually,
sorry, Ryan. Pardon me.
And then you're going to, if you double click on the camera.
Oh, we have to move Ryan again. Oh, sorry.
Put Ryan down in the project panel. You're docked. Double click on the rigid body FPS controller. So the camera is where your eyes are. The easiest way to change the height is just to change the Y position of the camera, not of the rigid body, but of the camera. So you have to expand the rigid body, select the main camera, and then just move it down on, if you go to the move tool, move it down on the green axis.
Move it down on the green axis.
So maybe to 0.5 might be.
You know what? You're trying to get the art to be the same height as your eyes?
Not specifically. John was just asking how to change the height of the audience member. What would you... How would you go about it, Ryan?
Oh, I'm just saying you can go make a reference object that's the size that you kind of want your camera normally at.
Yeah.
Do you know the dimensions? So a scale of an object, a unit in Unity is a meter. Like one unit is 1 meter.
Whoa. Okay. Cool.
And if you know that. So if you, I guess that's generally the idea. And so if you wanted to say, if you knew that your character was 2 meters tall, you could make a reference object and then use that to build your environment around.
Awesome.
So if you went into your main gallery with the photos, you could kind of match your eye line to that.
Cool. I love that. That's just part of the reason why you were asking for the measurements of the, or the reason
the
why
Dunlop,
you're asking the measurements of
plinth.
The plinth was to achieve that, right? In Unity?
Yeah.
Cool.
Nice to know your ratios. So the scale of the character versus the doorways you're going through and stuff.
If you click on rigid body FPS controller again, So move the main camera down a little bit more, maybe just to try.
Yeah.
Or you can make them taller, which is what John was saying.
That. Yeah, I'll make mine a little taller because you have to look up to see Sam.
Yeah.
You need a bit of a boost.
You should add some more directional
lights. Yeah,
now.
Some directional lights.
Spotlights?
Yes, spotlights. Sounds great. So I guess for that, I'll just be copying and pasting the ones that are already in the scene.
Totally, yeah.
So I'll navigate. I'll just go focus. Where's the one that I put recently? Spotlight 2, probably.
Yeah.
So I'm going to press F to focus. Ooh, admit. We have one. We have an additional.
And then hit the grid view.
Oh, here we go. Loading.
Okay, go on. Continue your directional lighting.
Oh, I hear you, John. We might have a bit of an echo of your audio.
Just a second.
I guess I hear me. I'm just gonna duplicate or some of these spotlights. So for Sam, for the sculpture. Wow.
Oh, weird.
It's too big. Cool. Sam is too big. This will cast some wild shadows. I'll put one more on. Duplicate. And then move that one like to the front of his face.
It's like the T-Rex skeleton.
Wow. That's great. Oh, maybe center him a little more.
I like how you can see the light reflected in.
Yeah, that's really nice. I wonder if it should be slightly more face on. So just using those tools are up here.
Perfect. He is perfect. Thank you.
Okay, let's do some testing. And I think then also.
What, I would, do you want to make him rotate slowly?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, that sounds great.
So select your Sam
sculpture.
But select them, him, the art in the sculpture. So mm-hmm. the place sculpture.
And so then, I'll also have a kinetic sculpture in my gallery.
Very kinetic. And then over in your inspector panel, hit add component.
Oh, I have to go to. New Sam model? This
no.
One? Oh, the place right. Sculpture. Yeah. Okay.
You component. Might as well add it to the topmost object. Just collapse that object so it's...
Not confusing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, John.
Oh, nice. That looks sick.
Very nice background.
Sweet. Let's add a component. So
adding.
If you click add component and then search for auto move.
This one. Auto move and rotate?
Yeah. And then go to rotate degrees per second.
So I'm collapsing that, expanding that. You might even say.
Yeah, and then give it a value of 5 on the Y.
5.
Yeah.
Cool. And
okay, so we'll
now I have to press
this.
Play. Okay, so I'm not even paying attention in this gallery. Probably has something to do about the body and surveillance. In digital media, so I'm just onward here. Wow.
That's what I'm talking about.
That's ridiculous.
Yay. Beautiful.
The rotating's nice.
Wow. And if you use the default Unity all the default Unity screen like sky screens and stuff, or the reflections, and it looks very accurate to what's outside.
Yeah.
Because we don't have a roof on this gallery.
John, have you had any luck making your own virtual gallery?
I haven't put too much. I've got one tiny thing in my virtual gallery. It's not nearly as exciting as this.
The Sam show.
Photo symmetry that you've
got going on. Well, it's something we can. It would be cool if people did tinker in these virtual galleries a bit more. It would be cool to put stuff together into a shared virtual gallery space.
Was the rotation thing a custom script that you
had? No. Yeah, thanks for asking. That's from the standard assets, which is inside this Unity package.
Wow, so majestic. Thank you, Risa, for your feedback and your idea to make him big. You'll notice also for folks putting in works on the walls that they've got that unlit shader, so they are not affected by the lighting. But if you wanted to, have it, we're still kind of shaking in the floor. if you wanted to make it a bit more. Yeah, we're shaking while we're looking at this painting. Gallery lighting, like, then you would do, we would change the shader as we did for Sam, which, yeah, we could, like,
so
show that.
Here's a question for you. I guess it's an idea. So, like, using sprites versus using materials?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, like, if you had, like, a PNG that had some transparent edges on it or something, you could bring in a sprite.
Yeah,
which is a different way of it's a different type of object in Unity.
And then sprites are also good because they automatically will have the aspect ratio, the correct aspect ratio. If you
yeah,
just
it
drag
preserves
them in.
Your scale, your ratio. Yeah.
I actually wrote a custom script that will change the size of the quad to fit these quads automatically to fit the ratio of the images that you drag onto them. And the only reason I did that was so we could overcome the additional step of having to change the import settings of your pictures from texture to sprite, just so we wouldn't have to just to overcome that one hump. But otherwise, yeah. I would totally go with sprites.
The other thing with sprites is you can't get like shading or like lighting properly on it.
Yeah, I like the unlit look though, because it makes it look like they're just a bunch of LED screens.
That's true. Yeah, as I said, intentionally for the screen medium.
Yeah, we could also show just quickly how to do a video in the in your art gallery as well.
Cool. I don't have a video of Sam.
Oh, I mean, you must somewhere.
I must somewhere, but.
Yeah, it's a good. You do that, and I'll set it up. So, I'll turn one of these into the video plane.
Great.
Oops. So, a video is. You just have to add to one of these planes. You just have to add a video player. It's called. So, add component. Selecting your plane, you go to add component and then search for video player. And then once you do that, whatever video clip you put here will just play into onto this material that you've made.
Is that video player?
What's that?
No, sorry. Does the video player handle, like, what kind of formats does it handle?
Yeah, good question. The MP4s and MOVs that I've thrown at it have worked. What else? I've tried.
Or is there like an ideal setting for videos?
I think it's pretty versatile. I'm just trying to think because I did some green screen. I did a bunch of stuff a while ago where I was trying to bring in videos with transparency and playing them onto it, those didn't work, which I think those were like uncompressed MOVs. So I think it likes compression more than uncompression. I don't know. I've just been able to do it. It works pretty universally.
It's sending to your multiple emails. I'm not sure which ones are sending to here.
John, can we look at your gallery?
Sure. I put my gallery as my background here.
Oh, nice.
Oh, yeah. Smart.
So,
that
was great.
My gallery is one sculpture because I was just getting the texture and normal maps and everything working.
Yes.
And it's because this is Hiram Powers' Greek Slave. Because we're working on a show for the Mackenzie about the history of whiteness. And so I've been trying in conversation with the Smithsonian that they did this 3D scan of the Greek slave. And because they have the plaster original, they don't want to display that in person. So they show a 3D scan in the in their gallery it. And then, but they also make the 3D scan in full resolution available for, with a complete Creative Commons Zero license. So you can do absolutely anything you want with the scan. You can even make profit off of it if you want to.
Oh,
but,
fantastic.
So we're looking at doing a full scale reprint of that sculpture instead of having to borrow a priceless artifact that has, you know, several million dollars of insurance value to worry about.
Yes. That's so great.
I love that.
From the 3D printer itself, like you're thinking of printing it or
yeah, will this be it? FDM printing?
I've been meeting with Shapeways, but we'll see who we actually end up printing with and if we actually do it. So I had this model just sitting in my downloads folder.
I also, I do like this presentation without walls too. The sort of like raft in the middle of the water looks nice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. It seems like the ideal viewing environment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Although the floor is maybe, maybe the floor is not necessary.
Just coming out of the water. Yeah. That's so nice.
That's, yeah. Well, if you want, if that, I mean, I love this, but if you add more stuff to it, we can also, we can combine that with the, into the samorama, the sam, what's it called? The, what was
sam, it? Samogrammetry.
Samogrammetry.
Sam, yeah. Photo, no, photosammetry.
samorama ding dong. Oh, you gave me a video.
Yeah, it is it, are you logged into your email there?
I am.
Your
I will work. Open it off
personal
screen.
Work, yeah.
Yeah, because so like sort of we were going over here, you can have you can open a bunch of different mediums media into your into Unity. You can display images, sculptures, video like we're about to, as well as audio is another huge part of it that we have not touched on at all, but yeah, you can do a lot with audio.
It's that one.
In my project, I had a subtle crowd sound in the background.
Yeah, I heard that.
I think there's maybe some construction outside or something in the sound that I have.
Oh, love it.
Where was it sampled from? Was it sampled from the Dunlop?
I'm not sure where I got it from. I kind of fumbled through a bunch of recordings ahead.
So here in so I just took this video, dropped it into my project panel, and then I have this video player component attached to this plane. So there's there's a little box.
Is it already in it, or did you have to add the component?
I had to add the component. So again, if you just you want to do
I'll
that,
move
Kat.
My head so that you can see it in the inspector panel.
Oh, yeah. Wait, let's look at it. Oh, it's my.
It's very weird moving from the live stream to jumping into the Zoom call, I have to say.
Yes. To be yeah. All of because you're all of a sudden part of it.
Yes.
Yeah.
And seeing yourself
being spectated upon. It's not. Yeah. It
yes, I'm no longer anonymous. I can't just do my things, my own things.
Yeah. Well, you can.
There we go.
Yeah, there you go.
The dilemma of having a camera.
Okay, so then here I've added this video player. I'm just going to drag the video I've imported into the video clip box here. I'm going to tell it to loop. Make sure it loops. And make sure it plays on awake. And then when we press play, let's see what happens.
Still nothing exciting here.
There.
And?
Beautiful.
Wow.
That's the video art.
That's the video
so
art.
So we have some video art. We have some photographic art. We have sculptural art in the tradition of Jeff Koons. Pop art, if you will. As well as comments on contemporary selfie culture. Mm-hmm. So who says that you can't do with a virtual gallery what you can do in a real gallery? Or you can't cover deep topics in a virtual gallery?
Oh, and it looks like when I leave, I can no longer...
You can't get
I can't get out anymore.
You're also
help,
stuck here now.
Help. Well, this is a good place to stay, I guess.
Hi, Brittany's in the chat. Hi. Nice to see you. Brittany, John was wondering if she can see you covered in sparkles all the time. Yes, pretty much, because I think, John, you could just have that effect going on
I
your Zoom calls.
I have that always. I can come to all of our meetings full sparkles.
It's hard to know where to draw the line professionally, but I think you should go for it. We've had you on the horn for almost 2 hours now, Ryan. So thank you so much for joining us in this journey and through a number of virtual galleries, your own and some of our own making. We'll keep Risa asked, where's the virtual art? Yeah, that's the next
the computer
step.
That you walk up to and like you're trying to visit the webpage.
Or the headset that you put on.
Oh yeah,
that would be the awesome next step. We can, if anyone, we'll still be hanging, or I'll still have the, I think I'll turn the, I'll shut the stream off in a moment. But if anyone still wanted to hang out, we can leave the things running for a little while, and you can access it through the Discord channel, which I will post again once more.
We've got another virtual gallery here. If you're not building one in Unity, like your Zoom call can become a virtual gallery.
Yeah.
Like I've got a Bastian Adder video playing here, and Ryan's got his work, and you've got your photosammetry.
And there's a whole discussion about backgrounds on Zoom calls. I mean, maybe we're all tired of that by now. But yeah, people have been pushing the limits of Zoom in various calling formats.
We're just posting that link to the Discord in the chat. As well, we will, in the Discord, we'll be resharing all the links that we shared today. So the links to Ryan's work, Artifacted, as well as the other galleries that we visited, the virtual galleries that we visited. And if you happen to have created a gallery today and have been a little shy, you can to come on the call, but let us know, because we could create an amalgamation of all the different gallery spaces that were created today, and make it so that you can explore it. So let us know.
And tune in next week when we'll be looking at more ways of presenting art on a computer, more virtual galleries, if you will. Specifically next week, we'll be talking to curator Faith Holland, who co-curated the recent Well Now WTF show, which is sort of exists not in a 3D virtual gallery like we've been looking at today, but on a website. So we'll be thinking about websites as gallery spaces next week at 7 p.m. Central Time, wherever you're watching this.
Regina Central Time, special Regina. Thank you so much, both John and Ryan, for participating. Is there anything you'd like
Regina
to plug?
Regina Central Time is different than other Central Time.
That's right what now. I thought. Yeah. Oh. It's special Regina Central Time. Because is
management.
How do you say that? What's the, or what's the, like, CS? It's not CST, or
it's
is
G,
it?
Is it like minus
it's
6
CT.
G? It's okay.
It's Central Time, but it's Central Standard Time elsewhere.
Everywhere else.
Central Standard and Central Daylight, but we just don't do them. So it's, you can say Saskatchewan time and then people will understand.
Cool. That sounds
is
cool.
Is that what
too.
ST stand? No, CT.
Doesn't Saskatchewan time show up in drop down lists for time zones?
Usually.
It does.
Usually it does.
Yeah.
Oh man, that's funny.
Certainly for my Animal Crossing game.
Which is what we'll be playing now.
No.
So, okay.
Thank you, Corey. Thank you for tuning in. But yeah, did Ryan or John, did you have anything you would like, any projects on the go, virtual galleries that you'd like to mention before?
Plugs, general
plugs. Any plugs?
I'm seeing somebody asking for the Zoom code in Facebook.
Oh.
Plug for Zoom.
Get to Zoom. Yeah, you
oh,
get.
Oh, is that for my mom from a Heather? Is that the question?
Yes.
From
is
my
your mom?
Mom
want to join the Zoom
I think
us?
My mom wants to join Zoom. Hi, mom.
Okay, I'm posting. I'll post the link in the. Just a second. Posting link. Then anyone who wants to can jump on in. the after party, but then we're going off stream. Ryan
plugs.
So yeah, I guess maybe the only plug I can think of right now is just my website right now is a guidewire at squarespace.com.
Let's get that on the.
Unfortunately, I need a new domain name, but maybe it's fine. I also have some music and a new video game coming out, Oriole Tales.
Oh, cool. That's awesome. Is it a specifically musical video game, or is it just like soundtrack to the video game?
It's not just a soundtrack.
Cool.
I'm posting the website in the chat. And wait, that was the wrong... Wait, what did I paste? Oh, actually, my grandfather would like to come in to the Zoom meeting. Amazing. Oh. Here is the right link.
Before we go.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any way you could open up this gallery space with the wall shifted over slightly?
This gallery space with the wall shifted over slightly?
Like to
do those walls move?
Yes. Well, they can. Okay, we're gonna stop this.
Yes.
I'm gonna stop the stream. So that
actually, well, first you put on the other put oh, that yes, cool looping right. video that that has Ryan's music in it.
Yeah.
Our out video right there.
Okay. Goodbye, everybody.
Goodbye, everybody. Bye. Thank you so much.
Goodbye.